Turn into our Bibles to the book of Exodus, chapter 25. Chapter 25 and verse 10. We'll get that started. The Bible says in verse 10, make an ark. Make an ark. This is the beginning of our study. You should have received your outline or your handout. And you should have received that so that you can see the picture of the ark, what it may have looked like, what it may have been size-wise and all of that. The ark is a very interesting piece of furniture. We're going to talk about that in just a moment. But in Exodus 25 and verse 9, the Bible says, according to all that I show you, that is, the pattern of the tabernacle and the pattern of all its furnishings, just so you shall make it. The Bible talks about the pattern of the tabernacle. When you came to the tabernacle, you saw in the handout last week the basic outline or the basic function or formation of the tabernacle. You came first to the gate, and there as you passed through the gate, you came to the brazen laver, and the brazen laver was the place where all the sacrifices were made. Brazen altar. And you came to the brazen altar, and that is where all the sacrifices were made. As a priest, you went a little further. You went to the brazen laver, and there at the brazen laver, you would wash your hands and you would wash your feet so that you would be prepared for service in the holy place there in the tabernacle. And you would go into the tabernacle, and there were three pieces of furniture: the table of showbread, the golden lampstand. I keep wanting to say menorah, but it's the golden lampstand. And there you go to the end of what, before the veil, is the altar of incense, the golden altar. That's in the holy place. But there before you is a great veil. You can't go past it. Perhaps as a member of the congregation of Israel, you could come to the brazen altar and there you could give your sacrifice, but you could go no further. As a priest, you could go there at the golden altar, the brazen altar. You could go to the brazen laver, and you could even go into, perhaps if it is your turn, to go into the place, the holy place, and do the service in there. But you could go no further. There was a block. There was something that stopped you. It was called the veil. And as we stop at the veil, we come to the most important part of the tabernacle, the Holy of Holies, the smallest cube-shaped room in the ark. We now stand in the most important room in the tabernacle, eventually in all the temples too. This is what the late Zola Levitt called the apartment of God on the earth. This is where God came, and he came into this little room. His Shekinah glory cloud would come down upon the tabernacle, and Moses would know it was time to go. And Moses was able to go past the veil any time to speak to God. Now, he was the only man on the face of the earth that ever lived from that point on who ever was allowed that. No one else was ever allowed. The only person who was allowed to go beyond that veil that separated man from God was the high priest, and only one time a year. Aaron was only allowed to go into the Holy of Holies one time a year, and that was at what we call today Yom Kippur, or the Day of Atonement, where the high priest would go, put the blood upon the ark, and make atonement for all the people of Israel. Now there, folks, we've had our look into the tabernacle. It is strange as we go to the book of Exodus, verse 25, that God begins his tour of the tabernacle with the last piece of furniture in this divine symbolic pattern of the tabernacle. As a human, I would have started as I did earlier, at the gate. That's the beginning point. That's where you go in. I would have started the gate as I did earlier, and I would have started with the altar of sacrifice. But you see, it pictures our salvation. And why not, as a human being, would I picture the most important thing in my life, my salvation? But you see, God did not start with man's salvation. God started with his perfection. God started with his holiness. God started with his presence. And God wanted us to understand that's how we're to see it. That God is preeminent over all things. That God is first in his word and foremost in his work. There is none like him. And so we must understand that it pictures God's preeminence. So we go first to the ark. In verses 10 through 16, we're going to consider the ark. We're going to take a look at its detailed construction. We're going to see the description of its contents. We're going to take a look not only at the ark, but we're going to take a look at the covering of the ark. We're going to look at its covering of the mercy seat and the cherubim of the mercy seat. We're going to see some interesting things today, very symbolic. Things that you and I have never seen before. Things that maybe one day we will get to see. Perhaps during the millennial kingdom, or even during the time we go into heaven to go into the temple there in heaven and see these matters. In verse 10 to 15, let's look at the details of the construction of the ark. You have the ark before you in this handout. I appreciate Andrew who did all of this for me. All of my children are very, very talented. I have some who are talented in art. Nathan did my cover for my book. He's very talented in art. Bethany's very talented in music. I'm talented with playing the radio. I do it very well, FM or AM, doesn't matter. We see the details of construction in verse 10. Look at the dimensions of the ark. In verse 10, we see the location of its positioning. And they shall make an ark of acacia wood. 2.5 cubits shall be its length, 1.5 cubits its width, and 1.5 cubits its height. And you shall overlay it with pure gold inside and out. You shall overlay it and shall make on it a molding of gold around it, a crown of gold around it. And you shall cast 4 rings of gold for it and put them in the 4 corners. 2 rings shall be on one side and 2 rings on the other side. And you shall make poles of acacia wood and overlay them with gold. You shall put the poles in the rings of the side of the ark, and the ark may be carried by them. The poles shall be in the rings of the ark, and they shall not be taken from it. What we see here in verse 16, it says, and you shall put into the ark the testimony which I give to you. We see in verses 10 through 15 this detail. In verse 10, again, the dimensions, the location of the positioning is simple. It is in the Holy of Holies. Not everyone gets to see this piece of furniture. In fact, more than likely, no one ever saw it except one man, the high priest, and Moses. That's it. When they carried the ark from place to place, they literally took the veil down with poles, and it would literally lay over the ark, and they would pick the ark up by the staves or the poles and move it. No one was to touch it. No one was to see it, look upon it. We see the ark was located in the Holy of Holies. This room was the smallest in the tabernacle. It was a cube, as I shared before. It was perfectly cube. It was a picture of heaven. There in the book of Revelation, if we had time, we could go to it, but in Revelation 21, 16, the Bible describes a new heaven and new earth and shows that it is a perfect cube. It is as high and it is wide. It is deep and it is long. The bottom line is simple. It pictures heaven on earth. Heaven on earth. Next, we see its logistical proportions. The measurements are in our handout. We see the cubits there. The cubits were mentioned. Cubits, we place that into what we call the feet today. 3.25 and 2.25. We see here, 2.5. We see here the dimensions of it. Now, what is a cubit? You say, I don't know what a cubit is, preacher. I never had that in school. No, you had inches and feet. And then some of you had the metric system. I have a problem with the metric system. I didn't grow up European. I don't have a European body. I can't wear one of those European tapered shirts. So I have a hard time with the cubit. Is easy to understand. It's not like the metric system. Here it goes. You ready? Cubit. Elbow to the top of your middle finger. Cubit. Simple. Not hard. You carry your ruler with you. It was basically very simple. We see the logistical proportion is that it was the throne room of God. The ark, therefore, was the throne of God, but it was not a place for him to sit. In verse 11 through 15, we see the distinction of the ark. It's significant and simple. Look at verse 11. We see its significance. And you shall overlay it with pure gold. With inside and out, you shall overlay it, and you shall make it on it a molding of gold around it. We see the only piece of furniture that was in this throne room. It's so significant, it only had one piece. If you go to the outer court, there are two pieces of furniture. If you go into the holy place, there are three pieces of furniture. But in the Holy of Holies, there's only one. One. Why? Because God's throne room is not to be shared with anyone. Only one piece, because God does not share his glory with anyone. Satan found that out, didn't he? See, Satan wanted to overthrow the throne of God. He wanted to put himself above the clouds, above the angels, above God. It was going to be not going to be God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, and Lucifer. It was going to be Lucifer, and that was it. But God prevailed, and we see that only God is magnified by this particular piece of furniture. It is the throne of God. It is made of precious metal. It is made of, notice the Bible says, pure gold. What is pure gold? Pure gold is gold that has been heated and the dross comes to the top. It's like silver. If you heat these precious metals, they will liquefy and they will come to the dross will come to the top. The impurities will come to the top and you just skim it off. How do you know when it's pure? How do you know when the metal is pure? It's simple. When you see your reflection in the metal, you know that it's pure. When you see the reflection of God in the life of people, in the life of things, and on these furnitures, you know that it's pure. We see its symbolism. It was made of wood and of pure gold. That's in verses 12 through 15. First of all, the wood was acacia wood. Acacia wood was, it pictured the humanity of Christ. How did that do that? Well, there are four significant factors we can look at this wood that pictures the life of Jesus. Four factors in this wood alone. Number one, it thrived in dry land. It was a tree that grew in the desert. It thrived in the arid and dry and thirsty lands, and it survived. It thrived. Well, just like Jesus, who came to a dry and thirsty land and thrived. He became our Savior. He came in a world that refused to receive Him. He came into His own and they received Him not. He came into a dry and thirsty land, but yet He prevailed. And yet He overcame. Next we see this tree had long, sharp thorns. Jesus came and we crowned Him King of the Jews with a crown of thorns. It had a gum resin, when extracted, was used for medical purposes. And Jesus was pierced too for our healing, as Isaiah said in Isaiah 53. By His stripes we were healed. It never rotted and was insect resistant. Jesus never decayed in the grave, and death was defeated by the resurrection. The psalmist said that His body never saw decay in the tomb. The body of Jesus lay in the tomb for 3 days and three nights. And He came forth that third day. And lo and behold, that tomb is still empty today. Good luck trying to find his body. Next, we come to the gold, the pure gold. And it pictured not the humanity of Christ, but it pictured the divine nature of Christ. The gold overlaid the acacia wood. Did you notice? Inside and out. You and I might be a little, perhaps, encouraged to hasten the display or hasten the building of it and say, well, let's just put it on the outside. People won't know what's in the inside. No big deal. Just put it on the outside. God said, no, it's got to be on the inside and outside. Why? Because that which was seen on the outside was that which was a reality in the inside. Jesus was the perfect divine Son of the living God. He was without sin. He was pure on the inside, and therefore he was pure on the outside. Jesus told us that it's what was in the man's heart that defiled the man, did he not? He said, told the leaders of the Jews, it's not what you eat. It's not the kosher, non-kosher foods that make you sinful. It's not what you take into your body. It's what comes out of the body is sinful. The human nature, the deprived nature of humanity. Folks, listen to me. The depraved nature of humanity is simple. We are sinners by birth. Here, Jesus was not a sinner by birth. He was born a perfect, divine man of God in human flesh with the acacia wood. We see here a perfect symbolism of Jesus. In verse 16, we see the description of its contents. Now, there's some discussion back and forth about what was truly inside the ark. In Hebrews 9, verse 4, it says, which had the golden censer, speaking of the Holy of Holies, which had the golden censer and the ark of the covenant overlaid on all sides with gold, and which were the golden pot that had the manna, Aaron's rod that budded, and the tablets of the covenant, or the Ten Commandments. Now, Paul, who wrote the book of Hebrews, talks about what was inside this ark. We had the Ten Commandments, we had the golden jar of manna, and then we had the rod of Aaron that budded. Now, there are some people, including many of the Jewish rabbis, who believe that that rod of Aaron, because of its size, was not inside the ark. But you didn't have to put the whole thing inside it, just a portion of it. But that it was laid outside leaning upon the ark, and that the jar of manna was also outside in the ark, and the only thing inside was the tablet. Well, in the beginning, that was true, because that was first, the tablets, the law. But later on, as we see, they kept adding inside the ark. God kept saying, I want you to put this in the ark, and lo and behold, we have all the different things that are in the ark. Now, all three of these things are very symbolic. Let's take a look at them. First of all, we see the symbol of God's perfection. That's the Ten Commandments. The law never gave us salvation. The law never pointed to us, you and I. You keep the law and you'll be saved. The Bible never says that. The Bible tells us that we cannot keep the law. It is perfect. We are imperfect. There was only one who came and kept the law perfectly, and that was Jesus. So we see the revelation of the law in God's perfection. It showed God as a holy and perfect God. But we see also in the Ten Commandments the redemption of God's provision. It points us to Jesus. The Ten Commandments were impossible for us to keep. You say, well, I haven't killed anybody yet. No, but many times, you know, there are other the commandments we break. And Jesus said, you break one, you've broken them all. And so therefore, as humans, we cannot keep the law. But Jesus came to keep the law and to be that perfect man that would be the perfect sacrifice for us. The law is holy. Man is sinful. And what the Ten Commandments shows us, we need a Savior. And so what we see here is the revelation and the redemption of God's provision. Now, Romans 10:4 says something very unique. It says, for Christ is the end of the law for righteousness to everyone who believes. Now, that word, the end, does not mean the conclusion. It doesn't mean the law is done away with. Jesus said, I come not to abolish the law, but to fulfill the law. Now, here's what this means. The law is not abolished. You still can't go out and commit murder. You still can't go out and commit adultery. You still can't go out and steal willy-nilly and do what you want to do. You can't go out and covet. God's law is still holy. It's still in effect. But we have a Savior who kept the law perfectly and willingly died for us, that if we believe in Him and trust in Him, we have forgiveness through His sacrifice. Now, that word end in the Greek is telos. Telos, T-E-L-O-S, telos. And what it literally means is the goal. What it means is the conclusion of an act, a purposeful ending. And what Paul is writing here is, for Christ is the fulfillment of the law for righteousness to everyone who believes. That's why Jesus said on the cross, telestai, it is finished. He died for our sins, that the law would not be abolished, but that it would be fulfilled through Christ. We see the symbol of God's perfection, the Ten Commandments. Next, we see the symbol of God's provision, the manna in the wilderness. God provides our every need. We see the sustaining provision of God. The children of Israel, as we see now, are in the wilderness. They're going to travel for 40 years. There are no McDonald's. There are no drive-up Wendy's. There are no Burger Kings. You can't say, hey, you want some takeout tonight? Let's go get pizza. Well, no. Mom, what's for dinner tonight? Manna. Well, we had that last night. Well, yeah, we've kind of had it for 40 years every night. What are we going to have for lunch tomorrow? Breakfast tomorrow? Manna. What are we going to have for lunch tomorrow? Manna. But you see, there was uniqueness, what you could do with manna. They baked it. They ground it. They did all kinds of stuff with it. They did all kinds of unique things with it. But it was still manna. So the whole bottom line was, though it seemed to be just manna, it was God's bread from heaven. It was white. It speaks of us, of the spotless purity of God. It was grounded and baked, and it speaks of us, of the suffering of a sinless Savior, pure and without sin for a sinful mankind. It was given to them to sustain them and to strengthen them in the world, in the wilderness. Oh, I like the psalmist in Psalm 23:1, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. Oh, I've ate some great meals in different places. I've had some different meals all over the world. But you know what? I always wanted more. I always thought, you know, if that just had one extra piece on that pizza, this would be pretty good, you know? What happened to all those wings? I thought there was one left. You see, it never fulfills us. But the Lord sustains and He fulfills us with this beautiful, beautiful provision. Jesus said in John, the 6th chapter, I am the bread of life. The great leaders had come to Him and said, hey, Moses gave us the bread from heaven. What are you going to do for us? And Jesus said, Moses didn't give you the bread from heaven. My Father gave you the bread from heaven, and I am the bread from heaven. He who believes in me shall never die. And He said to them, I am the bread of life. And lo and behold, beloved, we see the picture of the manna, the bread of life, and Jesus. Next, we see the third thing that's in the ark, and that is the symbol of God's position. This was Aaron's rod that budded, the provision of Aaron's authority. We don't have time to go to Numbers 17. They had a dispute among the brethren. Basically, it came out of Moses and Aaron's cousin's family, and they said, hey, how come you get to do all this stuff? You know, God doesn't have, you got no right to do all this. God says he speaks to you, but you know, God can speak to all of us. We heard his voice just like you. There was a great fight. Eventually it had to come down to God selecting the one. And so they wanted to know, okay, why is Aaron so special? And God says, because I have selected him. And here's what I want you to do. He says, I want all the leaders of all the tribes to take your staff. And I want, Moses, you to take it in and put it in the Holy of Holies next to the tabernacle. And the one that buds is going to be the one who is the leader. Now they wrote all their names on their cane, on their staffs, and they put them in the Holy of Holies. The next morning, Moses brought out all the staffs. They were all dead twigs. You don't have a staff that's alive. You break the branch off, you clean it up, you mark it, do whatever you want to do with it, make it a nice little staff. But Aaron's budded. And Aaron's not only budded, but it bore fruit. It was of the almond tree. And the almond tree was a picture of resurrection, because it was the first tree of all to blossom in the spring. And it was a picture of the death of winter and the beginning of life in springtime. And so Aaron's rod that budded was a picture of his authority. And lo and behold, it was a picture of the proof of Christ's authority. And what is that? You destroy this temple, Jesus told the leaders, and in 3 days, I'll raise it up. And they said, oh, it took 60 years to build what we're building today, and we're not even completed yet. How can you do it in 3 days? Jesus did not speak of Herod's temple, but he spoke of his body, the temple of God. And lo and behold, there in the grave it lay for 3 days and three nights. And it came out of that old cave. It came out of the ground. It came out of the grave triumphant, so that you and I can see this is indeed the Holy Son of God. The one who we give authority to. I don't give authority to any man in this world. I don't care who he is. I don't care what party he represents or she represents. Beloved, Jesus is the overall leader in this world, and I follow him. Jesus said to her in John 11:25, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me, though he may die, he shall live. Listen, folks, Republican Party can't give me that promise. The Democrat Party cannot give me that promise. There are no institutions in this world, no leader in this world that can give me that promise. His staff budded to life, folks. That which was dead, an old stick dead, came back to life. And that old body they lay in the tomb and wrapped with linen and with spices upon it came back to life, a resurrected Savior. Beloved, I tell you, it's an interesting thing that the tabernacle can show us. We're going to look at one more piece in the tabernacle, and it's the covering of the ark. Now we see it, we know it today as the mercy seat. So we start with verse 17. And you shall make a mercy seat of pure gold. 2.5 cubits shall be its length, and 1.5 cubits its width. And you shall make 2 cherubim of gold of hammered work. You shall make them at the 2 ends of the mercy seat. Make 1 cherub at 1 end and the other cherub at the other end. You shall make the cherubim at the 2 ends of it of 1 piece with the mercy seat. And the cherubim shall stretch out their wings above, covering the mercy seat with their wings, and they shall face one another. The faces of the cherubim shall be toward the mercy seat, and you shall put the mercy seat on the top of the ark, and in the ark you shall put the testimony that I will give you. What we see in verse 17 and verse 21, the covering of the mercy seat. Now we see the proportions of the covering in verse 17. Its composition, pure gold. No wood at all, pure gold. The Talmud says that it was possibly 4 inches thick. Now what is 4 inches thick? Take my thumb to my little finger, that's 4 inches. I took the ruler, showed it. So I got to have something to show what 4 inches look like. Here it is, 4 inches. Okay? About the width of your hand. And we see here that it was a very valuable piece of furniture. Its composition, pure gold, which spoke of the divinity of God. We see its calculations. It was the same size as the ark's body. And it covered every inch of that opening in the ark. The purpose of the ark in verse 21 was simple. The purpose of the covering, note its regard in verse 21. You shall put the mercy seat on top of the ark. It was a lid, not an altar. It was where God's Shekinah glory cloud rested. The sacrifice was not made in the ark. The sacrifice was not made at the ark. It was made all the way back at the altar of sacrifice, all the way back at the very beginning of the tabernacle. The first thing you saw was the blood. The first thing you saw was the sacrifice. The first thing you saw was the giving of the propitiation for the souls and the sin of mankind. But all the way back at the ark, all the way at the end, all the way through the tabernacle was that ark. And it was the throne of God where once a year the high priest would place the blood of the offering for the sins of all the nation of Israel. And where Moses would go and speak to God and listen to God. And so we see here its regard. We note its rank. It was a holy desk for a holy work. It's where God came and he shared the revelation of his will and his purpose and his being to Moses. The only thing we can come close to it, the only thing that we could say that was a piece of furniture like the mercy seat was simple, the pulpit. We speak and preach the word of God. We give you the mind of God. We give you the will of God from the word of God. And that's exactly what happened when Moses would go to God's pulpit. So we notice rank. Now we're going to note its role. It's a place where the blood was applied. Without the blood, there was no forgiveness. The mercy seat of God was where the blood was put once a year for all of Israel. Now the mercy seat is a very interesting word. In the Hebrew, the word is kipporeth. Kipporeth. And it literally means a covering. Now, in Israel today, Jewish people today, whether it be in Israel or in America or in Europe or South America, wherever they're at, they wear a little hat. You've noticed that. Perhaps you've seen that. Many of them have different colors. They can be white. It can be black. It can be brown. It can be multi. I've seen one. It had the Florida Gator emblem on it. Must have been a Southern Jewish person, huh? But they wear that hat because they believe that's what God would have them to do. It's called a kippur, and it means covering. And now a Jewish person, a very observant Jewish person, will not pray or go into the synagogue without a covering. I've seen Jewish people who were caught without their covering as they began to pray. They stuck their hand on top of their head because they wanted to be covered. If you go to the Western Wall today and you're a good Gentile and you don't carry your kippur with you all the time, or what they say in the Yiddish, a yarmulke, you don't carry your yarmulke with you, they give you one. It's a little paper one that's kind of full. It looks like a French fry cup thing, you know. It looks like, man, are we getting fries too? This is great, you know. And you put it on top of your head and you walk up to the wall and you can pray. But you don't. If you don't have one on your head, you don't walk up to the wall. You don't get to go there. But literally it means a covering. That's why in Psalm 32 in verse 1 it says, blessed is he whose transgression is forgiven, whose sin is covered. Oh, you see, they wear that covering to remember that God forgives. You've got the covering over the ark to remind us God forgives. It's the mercy seat. In verse 18 through 20, we see the cherubim of the mercy seat. In verse 18, we see their figurative significance. And you shall make the boards for the... wrong chapter. Verse 25, 18. And you shall make two cherubim of gold, of hammered work. You shall make them at the two ends of the mercy seat. We see their number, two. Two symbolizes harmony. Two witnesses are in harmony. Amos 3:3 says, can two walk together unless they're agreed? So the two are together, they're in harmony. They're witnesses. They're witnesses of God's holiness. They're witnesses of God's will. They see the number. Then we see their nature, their gold. They project the divine nature of a holy God. In Revelation 14, verse 10, it says, in the presence of holy angels and in the presence of the Lamb. God's angels in heaven are holy because He is holy. Would to God that you and I would be holy as God is holy. They don't have a sin nature to deal with as we do. In verse 18 through 20, we see their functional service. Their placement was simple. In verse 18 and 19, they were placed on the lid, facing each other, showing agreement. Well, how do you know that, preacher? Well, listen to me. If you're not agreed, you don't usually face each other unless you're going to punch somebody in the nose. Usually, if you're in disagreement, you turn your back on the person, right? So they are in agreement with each other. Verse 20, we see their protection. Their outstretched wings are used to protect the blood upon the seat. Now listen, folks, Jesus' ministry was based on the protection of His wings. Now wait a minute, preacher, Jesus didn't have any wings. Well, you know, some people believe that the tallit, the prayer shawl, was what they were talking about the wings of Jesus. That as you put that prayer shawl on, you open it up and it looks like wings. And it talks about Jesus coming that way, but you know, some people believe that. That's okay. Matthew chapter 23, verse 37, Jesus said, O Jerusalem, Jerusalem, the one who kills the prophets and stoned those who are sent to her, how often I wanted to gather your children together as a hen gathers her chicks under her wings. But you were not willing. Jesus' wings is His grace, His mercy, His protection. Psalm 36:7 says, How precious is your loving kindness, O God. Therefore the children of men put their trust under the shadow of your wings. We see their protection. Finally, in verse 20, we see their perception. Both cherubim face each other and look at the mercy seat. You know, children look around everywhere, don't they? They just look everywhere. And they stare where they're not supposed to stare, don't they? Now, the angels could have looked all around and could have had a head that swiveled around, I suppose. You know, those bobblehead things, they're kind of spooky, aren't they? You ever see one of those bobblehead things? You ever seen those pictures of Jesus? They got little ceramic things and His eyes follow you? Kind of creepy. You walk into a room and there's those eyes looking at you. Walk over the other side of the room and, ooh, He's still staring at me. You see, the angels weren't bobble-headed. They had their heads down to the lid of the seat. Why? Why was that? Because they put their gaze upon the mercy seat where the blood was applied. They were looking at the blood. They were looking towards Calvary. And they were looking toward the atonement of Jesus on the cross. You see, the Old Testament, you looked forward to the coming of the Messiah. You looked forward to the cross of Christ. Whereas in the New Testament, we look back to the cross. We look back to the atonement. We see they looked forward towards the cross and towards the atonement on Calvary. Finally, in verse 22, as we close, and there I will meet with you, and I will speak with you from above the mercy seat, from between the two cherubim which are on the ark of the testimony, and everything which I will give you in commandment to the children of Israel. It was a place of revelation, was it not? And it was a place of reward. What do you mean? If the children of Israel good, God rewarded them from the ark. He told Moses, this is what we need to do, this is what we're going to do, and here's how I'm going to reward them. And God shared the whole revelation. He shared the revelation of grace. He shared the revelation of judgment. Oh, what's that a picture of, preacher? It's simple. Turn your Bible to 1 Corinthians chapter 3. 1 Corinthians chapter 3. One day, beloved, Christian, you and I are not going to go to the judgment seat, of the great white throne judgment, the judgment of sinners. We're not going to do that. You see, our judgment was at the brazen altar. Our sins were judged at the brazen altar. As I shared with you before, the ark is not the seat of judgment of sin. We're going to go into the great tabernacle of life. We're going to go past the altar. We're going to receive Jesus as our Savior. We're going to go to the brazen laver and we're going to submit to the baptism that Christ would have us submit to. And then we're going to go into the holy place and we're going to serve Christ by communion with the saints and with the Lord. And we're going to have the great light of the menorah in our life. And we're going to serve the light of the world by sharing our witness in the light of the word, how we're going to read the Bible. And then we're going to come to the altar of incense and we're going to continue to pray and continue to follow and continue to speak to the Lord. One day, all of that concludes as we stand one day before the great veil of life. Remember how Paul talked about the veil? Remember how Paul talked about passing through the veil? We're going to go through that veil called death one day, beloved. And we're going to go through there. And when you stick your hand in that icy, icy veil of death, you're going to feel another hand on the other side. And it's going to be Jesus pulling you through, beloved, and saying, come on in, boys, the water's fine. And as you go in through that veil and stand before the Lord, you're going to stand before that holy altar, that holy ark. And there's judgment coming, but not the judgment of sin, the judgment of works. Look at verse 9 in 1 Corinthians chapter 3. And we are God's fellow workers. You are God's field. You are God's building. According to the grace of God, which was given to me as a wise master builder, I have laid the foundation and another builds upon it. But let each one take heed how he builds on it. For no other foundation can anyone lay than that which is laid, which is Jesus Christ. And if anyone builds on this foundation with gold and silver and precious stones, wood, hay, and straw, each one's work will be clear, for that day will declare it, because it will be revealed by fire. And the fire will test each one's work of what sort it is. And if anyone's work which he has built on endures, he'll receive a reward. If any man's work is burned, he will suffer loss, but he himself will be saved, yet so as through fire. We see here in verses 9 through 15, the judgment throne called the judgment seat of Christ. We're going to stand before Jesus one day and give an account of our life. Live for him, beloved. What we did for him, how we lived for him, where we went and what we did. Not for sins. He's not going to judge our sins, beloved. He's going to judge what we did for him. Was it truly for Christ or was it for me? You say, boy, you're a preacher. You ought to get a lot of good rewards. Not necessarily. Who'd I do it for? For me? For you? Or for Christ? And so we see here, beloved, we have to stand before the Lord one day. But I got good news. You say, well, I'm scared. That scares me, preacher. I don't want to stand before Jesus like that. Well, let me tell you, beloved, prepare now. Start serving Christ now. Get involved in your prayer life. Get involved in reading your Bible. Get involved in sharing the word. Get involved in communion and fellowship. But better yet, beloved, the judgment seat of Christ has a very unique name. It's called the mercy seat. I'm scared to go before Jesus, preacher. It's the mercy seat. It's the mercy of God. He's going to provide mercy on that day. You say, well, what if I don't get any rewards? The Bible says you're going to get still heaven. The Bible says you're still going to be saved just as if by fire. And the way I like to use that verse is to simply say it this is how I interpret it. You're going to get in by the seat of your pants. Your pants are going to be smoking as you're going through. The bottom line is, folks, you don't want that in your life. You want to live for Jesus. His mercy is real. His mercy is great. His mercy is without limitation. You can stand before God at His mercy seat and walk away with crowns of reward. What a joy to stand before Jesus and hear Him say, well done, thou good and faithful servant. Oh, beloved, you don't want to go before Jesus at the mercy seat with nothing, empty-handed. An old non-Christian, lost person, you've never invited Jesus into your heart. I'm a good person. I've gone to church all my life. Maybe you have, but you've never invited Jesus into your heart. You have no hope at the mercy seat. Your judgment comes at the altar of God's judgment. Lost person, you can come to Jesus today and find the mercy seat right down here. Take me by the hand. We'll show you in the Bible how you can be saved. What a glorious opportunity. Christian, come down here. Recommit your life. Say, in 2017, I'm going to live for God and stand before Him one day, fresh and clean, living for Him at the mercy seat. Let's pray.
Hi, my name is John Blair, and I have the privilege of being the pastor here at Coventry Baptist Church in Fort Wayne, Indiana. I want to thank you for choosing to take part in our online services. I sincerely hope they were a blessing to you, and I want to invite you to continue to use them in the weeks yet ahead. In fact, take your time on our website, check it out, let us know what you think about it. Your opinion is very important to us, and we'd like to have some feedback. Let me take this time to also extend an invitation to you. If you don't already have a church home, let me invite you to come to our church and take part in one of our weekly services. Our morning worship service on Sunday is at 10 a.m. Our Sunday night service is at 6 p.m. And our Wednesday services and our midweek service is at 7 o'clock p.m. We're located at 10926 Aboit Center Road. We're right across the street from Homestead High School. Just get on our website. We have a detailed map and some instructions on how to get here. Again, thank you for choosing our website and our services. I pray that the Lord will bless you and keep you. I hope to see you this Sunday.
Blessed be the tie that binds our hearts in Christ.